All right, this is Susan Haynes, and this is fall 2011. I want to give a brief review of complex numbers and the complex plane. This is not for the beginners. This is intended to be a reminder of how these things work for people who have seen them before but haven't seen them in a while. If you are a beginner, then I advise you to go elsewhere, because I don't think this is the right place for you. Okay, so we're going to look at complex numbers. And I want to just do a quick introduction and reminder. Okay, so first of all, complex numbers. We have a number plane right here where I've got two axes. So clearly we'll be dealing with two-dimensional numbers. This, the horizontal axis is the real axis, and the vertical axis is the imaginary axis right here. Now, the real axis is marked off by this unit length right here. So that's how we know, how we can identify the different numbers that are along the real axis. Similarly, along the imaginary axis, we have a unit length, which is the same length as this one, but these numbers right here going up this direction are the unit is I. So I have I, 2 times I, 3 times I, and so on. So a particular number in this space right there can be represented in three different ways, really. Well, two different ways that have different kinds of notations each. So the standard way is using a Cartesian system. I mean, the standard, you know, good old junior high school way is a Cartesian system. So this number right here could be represented as AB. Two dimensions, because obviously I'm in a two-dimension plane for this single point. And what this means is my number is A plus I times B. So there's a real part and an imaginary part. So for this number right here, this would have size A, and this right here is size B. So A times 1 for the real part, and I times B for the imaginary part. Okay, another way of representing this number is in the polar coordinate system right here. And in the polar coordinate system, we use the same transform that that you did back in high school. You need to know what is the radius, that is the distance from the origin to your point right there. And then you need to know this angle between the horizontal axis and the vector going to your point. So this distance from origin to your point is r, or radius. This angle is theta. So there's a so I can have a point which is r theta, where x equals r times cosine theta, and y equals r times sine theta. And of course, this number right here is in a complex plane, so my number is actually x plus I times y, which equals r cosine theta plus I times sine theta. So there's the two way I could represent my number in the polar coordinate system. There is another extremely important way to think about representing these numbers, and that's using the phasor notation. And this is what we will be, the reason I'm talking about complex numbers right now is to prep people for understanding the Fourier transform. And the phasor notation, oops, I spelled phasor wrong, tisk. Bad on me, phasor. The phasor notation is a much easier to handle style of polar notation like this. And it uses Euler's law, which says that e to the r times I theta equals r cosine theta plus r times, well, I times r times sine theta. Okay? So this will be the notation that we will be using the most often when dealing with Fourier transforms. Okay, I need to stop this and move on to operations for my next set of lectures.